The next item of business is a debate on motion 13197 in the name of Mark Griffin on Scotland's housing emergency. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer members to my register of interest, which shows that I ceased to be the owner of a private rented property last summer. Almost exactly 6 months ago, with the support of Shelter Scotland, I moved a motion for the Parliament to declare a housing emergency in Scotland, and I moved the motion in my name, again supported by Shelter. I warned of the estimated 700,000 people who are in housing need, more than 9,000 children in temporary accommodation, and two councils declaring housing emergencies. The government at the time assured us that it would work to ensure that we have the right range and choice of homes to allow our communities to thrive. 6 months ago, the government refused to admit there was a problem. The minister listened to the scale of the challenge, assessed the solutions, and then sat by while his government slashed the affordable housing supply budget by 26%. That decision made a bad situation impossible. A household becomes homeless every 16 minutes. Around 10,000 children are now in temporary accommodation. Three more councils have declared housing emergencies, and more are likely to follow. The Scottish Housing Regulator has warned that 10 local authorities are at risk of systemic failure in homelessness services. House building's collapsing. There are 24% fewer new houses being built in Scotland this year. Housing associations are building less houses than at any point since 1998. West and Berkshire Council has told us that it's now in a position where it's highly unlikely to be able to approve any new social housing developments this year. Fife has predicted that the number of new social rented house starts could be reduced by 50%. That is a direct result of Scottish Government cuts. Now, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments in the media today. She's asking Parliament to unite with one voice and work across all spheres of government to tackle this housing emergency, but frankly lodges a self-congratulatory amendment which blames everyone and everything but the government. The first step in this has to be taking responsibility for the fact that there are 10,000 children in temporary accommodation, that not enough homes are being built, that far too many homes are lying empty, and to start to come up with solutions for that. We've come to this chamber repeatedly with those solutions. Some have been adopted, but far more still can be. We asked the government to increase council tax on second homes, provide more support for those struggling with mortgages, and create a national acquisition programme which would allow for properties to be purchased with tenants in situ to prevent homelessness. The government agreed and started progressing those, not as quickly as we would have liked, but we have suggested so much more. This government should be setting an all-tenure house building target, reversing years of undersupply. The housing requirements in NPF4 need to be revised and increased urgently. The planning system needs to be reformed and properly resourced, particularly with the drain of planning expertise into the renewable sector and away from housing and council planning departments. We've suggested additional national resource to support local authority teams dealing with applications of national significance, of which housing absolutely is. Alongside second homes, council tax on empty homes should be increased, and that funding should be used to build more homes too. Councils should have powers over compulsory sale and rental orders to force those empty homes back into use, removing blight from communities and giving families a home. That we should look at the use of discounted homes for sale, permanently reduced in the title deeds, creating a positive cycle of affordable home ownership. We've suggested looking at continental Europe and the innovative £1 homes model to encourage people to take on long-term empty homes and do the work to bring them back to life. We've talked about housing voids and the huge difficulties that councils and housing associations have in getting electricity supplies connected to allow them to be allocated to a family who needs them. And it's all because Cyrenians and others, they're telling us that emergency accommodation is at full capacity every single night, that temporary accommodation is usually full by 8:30 in the morning here in this city. When charities are saying there is a housing emergency, when councils are saying there is a housing emergency, when the private sector is saying there is a housing emergency, when the public are telling us loud and clear that there is a housing emergency, there is no longer a debate. There is a housing emergency in Scotland. And I'm pleased that the government has finally come to terms with the reality that we're facing. Now it must set out a clear plan of action to end the emergency it helped create. Because we're all living with the consequences of the economic illiteracy of a Tory government. A Labour government will sweep the Tories out of office and make better choices for this country, but we will need to take stock of the public finances and pick up the mess that we inherit. But now the SNP has found the political will within 6 months to declare an emergency, it must use every single available political and financial tool it has at its disposal to end it. Because, Presiding Officer, I have been absolutely clear that we need to build more houses across all tenures. We've set out a range of policies on making homes affordable and help for those facing that mortgage time bomb. So I'm glad that the government has finally admitted we have a problem. I look forward to seeing a government action plan and more crucially, a delivery plan in conjunction with Shelter and the other organisations that have contributed to the debate today, that ends the housing emergency, that gets those kids in warm, safe, secure homes, because the people at the sharp end of this government-created crisis don't have any more time to wait.
Thank you. I now call on Paul McLennan to speak to and move Amendment 13197.3. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I move an amendment in my name. I welcome this afternoon's debate on housing. And before I get into the substance of what I'm going to say, and Mark Griffin knows I meet with him and Miles Briggs on a regular basis, and happy to meet to discuss any of the issues that he's talked about and any of the ideas that he's got. And again, I'll touch on that in a little second. So today's debate offers the chance to recognise the current housing emergency in Scotland, the reasons behind it, and what we can do collectively to tackle it. In John Swinney's first speech as First Minister last week, he remarked that this Parliament, and I quote, is not the collaborative place it has been in the past. And he's correct. And he had committed his government to working to create more agreement across the Chamber. I would like to use today's debate to reach out to colleagues. I already do, and that was touched upon in the Claring debate yesterday. I intend to put all my energy into working collaboratively with you to deliver more social and affordable homes, to strengthen tenants' rights and end homelessness. I call on all of you to join me on this mission. Now, I want to touch on some of the achievements of this government, because I think context is really important. This government is not afraid to challenge the status quo and to take bold decisions when they are needed. We abolished priority need in 2012. This was an immense milestone that really set Scotland apart. It provided a right to settled housing for homelessness households and showed that Scotland was serious about ending homelessness. In 2016, Scotland ended the right to buy, a UK government policy that resulted in the sale of 500,000 social homes in Scotland. 500,000. Take that into context. 500,000 homes. As a result of this ambitious move, we estimate up to 15,500 homes have been protected and will remain available to renters now and in the future. We changed local connection rules in 2022, giving people more choice in where they settle. We have taken firm action to reduce the use of unsuitable bed and breakfast accommodation and night shelters, and are discussing these with the local authorities as we speak. We've embraced system change. The shift to rapid rehousing marked a cultural move away from that idea that prospective tenants have to be tenancy ready before being offered a settled home. We continue to fund the transition to rapid rehousing and expansion of Housing First. Yep.
Willie Rennie.
I appreciate that you want to defend the record, but isn't that record led us to this position today where the government's conceded that there is a housing emergency? So what new is he going to do to reflect this emergency that he's now admitted?
Minister.
Yeah, thank you, and thanks to the member. I think there's an important context in terms of where we are. We're talking around about interest rates being at the highest level that they've been for a number of years, and that's obviously impacting on the whole sector. Mark Griffin talked about alternative approach, and I share that approach, but that's impacted right across the sector. We've talked about construction costs. Again, that's been very hard on the sector in terms of that. So context is very important. I'll come on to some of the points that you've raised about what we're going to be doing next. So we have embraced system change. That shift to rapid rehousing, I said, marked a cultural move away from the idea about being tenancy ready. I am proud of Scotland's record on housing and homelessness, but want to do much more. Of course, we're proud of what we've done. We want everyone to have a safe and affordable home that meets their needs. We are making available nearly £600 million this year towards the delivery of more and affordable social homes. Now, this housing... I'm struggling for time. I've only got 5 minutes. Happy to pick it up after. This includes a recent boost of £80 million over 2 years to facilitate the acquisition of existing properties and help reduce the number of households in temporary accommodation. Since 2007, we've worked with partners to deliver more than 128,000 affordable homes, over 19,500 of which were for social rent. This has seen 40% more affordable homes delivered in Scotland per head of population than in England, and over 70% more than in Wales. But we need to be doing more, and I'm not going to deny that. Of course we need to be doing more. We remain committed to delivering our target of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our rural and island communities. We know that we need more social homes in order to end homelessness. We are taking action to increase housing supply, but some matters are beyond our control. Now, this is where I touched a point around about not just being Scottish Government. The UK Government needs to play a part, and the incoming UK Government needs to play its part also. Inflationary pressures, the impacts of Brexit and wider market conditions have contributed to rising construction costs and workforce challenges. We will keep working to mitigate the effects of these, but the UK Government's policies continue to shape the housing market and having lasting impacts. And I've already discussed this with Mark Griffin, talking about what we can do to discuss if it is an incoming Labour Government, how can we work together? And he knows that, and I'll continue to do that as we move forward. Local government also needs to play its part. We know that local authorities are working extremely hard to deliver services for people experiencing homelessness, and we urge councils to continue working with us. Now, I'm meeting all local authorities in 2 weeks' time to discuss this issue around about voids, about allocations and empty homes. We have seen tremendously innovative practice in some councils where permanent homes, temporary homes are flipped to permanent tenancies. Others can learn from this. In certain areas, we are keen to see local authorities increase the pace and activity when it comes to empty homes and vacant council properties. While it will not completely solve our supply problems, making best use of existing stock will help meet local housing needs. So we'll be inviting the local authorities and associations to revisit their allocations policies and check that they remain fit for purpose during this current housing emergency. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to have been reappointed as Housing Minister. I commend the huge and important steps taken in the last 25 years to improve housing policy and end homelessness. I do not want us to go backward. We are facing major housing challenges, but this afternoon offers
you
a
must
chance
conclude,
to
Minister.
Take of stock already what's been achieved and agree what can be more to done to tackle housing emergency. Thank you.
Thank you. We are very tight for time this afternoon. I now call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move Amendment 13197.2 up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Labour Party for bringing forward this debate today? The Scottish Government's strategies for housing and homelessness are failing, and any attempt to say otherwise is starting to feel like an attempt to gaslight the Scottish public. Not my words, but those of Shelter Scotland's director. Now, last week, the First Minister did state that he wanted to be honest about where the Scottish Government has been going wrong. So I welcome the acceptance from the Cabinet Secretary that ministers are failing to deliver on housing in Scotland and that Scotland is in a housing emergency. Sadly though, and I think we've seen this today, the Scottish Government don't seem to be bringing forward the humility and acceptance of their policy failures on their watch, just more deflection and the usual SNP playbook of blaming everyone else and not taking responsibility. Because housing, very briefly, if we have any time.
Minister.
Thank you, and thanks to the member for taking that mention. If he's talking about taking responsibility, does he accept a 9% cut in the capital budget impacts on what we can do in Scotland?
Miles Briggs.
Well, housing policy in Scotland has been devolved for 25 years, 17 of those years with this SNP government. The government motion desperately tries to suggest that a housing emergency is due to, and I quote, factors out of the Scottish Government powers, but there's no mention of the SNP Green Government's annual cuts to affordable housing budgets, no mention of the Scottish Government's failing national planning framework, which is now seeing land supply disappearing, no mention of the cuts to local government budgets, or the fact that Edinburgh City Council, which now has some of the highest homeless rates in the country, has lost out approximately £9.3 million in homelessness prevention funding under this government. No mention of the rent controls policy, which, as ministers were warned about, has seen rent soaring and has led to landlords withdrawing properties from the market, housing associations scaling back their property investment portfolios, and the complete loss of mid-market rent. No mention of the fact that under this SNP government, 40,000 disabled people in Scotland currently are on waiting lists for housing association and council homes. This is the SNP and Green Party's record in office, and it is time that they accept it. They have failed Scotland, and they need to take responsibility. Now, Shelter Scotland have stated it is a national scandal, and I agree. Scotland is in the grip of a devastating housing emergency which damages lives every single day. Local authority homelessness services are in systemic failure across the country. Five councils declaring housing emergencies, routine failures by local authorities to even uphold legal housing rights, a failure to deliver the social homes we urgently need, and a significant slowdown in new social housing developments just over the last year. This is an emergency that's damaging people's health, well-being, education and our economy, and leaves thousands of our fellow Scots without anywhere to call home. Now, Scottish Conservatives have repeatedly called for the Scottish Government to declare a national housing emergency, but these calls have fallen on deaf ears until now. So SNP ministers need to play catch-up. As crisis say in their briefing, declaring a national housing emergency will only be of benefit to Scotland if success is clearly defined and action targeted at the root causes and action taken swiftly by the Scottish Government. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, SNP ministers have had to be dragged kicking and screaming into accepting the reality that we are facing a housing emergency in Scotland. Ministers must now acknowledge where their policies have failed and reach out to charities and across the political divide for new ideas and fresh thinking. We must see ministers act and urgently outline to Parliament what will change across all government portfolios and what fresh leadership will actually be brought to this housing emergency, like with the drug deaths crisis and public health emergency government declared there. Scottish ministers need to bring forward an urgent housing emergency plan. That is why I hope we will not just see this debate, but cross-party talks and the Scottish Government bring forward an urgent statement on the national housing emergency in coming weeks. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. And I now call on Arianne Burgess. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, circumstances have changed, with 10 local authorities covering nearly half the population either at or close to crisis point. Close to 10,000 children are stuck in the misery of temporary accommodation with no safe home to grow up in. Declaring a housing emergency must lead to collective action and shared responsibility to tackle this crisis using all the means at our disposal. Local authorities across the country are taking bold steps to respond to the housing emergency. In my region, Argyll and Bute Council are addressing the emergency through a collective commitment with partners, stakeholders, investors and communities to tackle their housing shortages. They put in place a robust housing plan through Partnership Working and are using all the tools available to them. They've doubled council tax on holiday homes and introduced short-term let zones. They're rolling out housing in the Dunbeg corridor with 300 houses nearing completion and more to follow. They have two empty homes officers and have used the devolution of empty property relief to incentivise property owners to get properties back in use in under a year. They are supporting community-led housing on several islands and enabled the use of the rural housing burden. Despite this, a constituent told me recently that they would become homeless as there was no rental property available for them in their home of Tyree. Their household includes key roles. I'm sorry, I'm really short on time and I've got a lot to cover. Their household includes key roles in social care and local medical practice and the school. They also volunteer as Coast Guards and firefighters. The community in Tyree can ill afford to lose young islanders in this way, yet in just a few weeks they will have no option but to move to the mainland. There are 10 applicants for every social let in Tyree and neighbouring Col. Key issues that councils can't address alone need a national approach. The per metre build cost is too high. Specifying the use of homegrown Scottish timber and a new micro-housing building standard is part of the solution. Across the country, planning departments see consented sites stalled. Momentum needs to be behind developers, requiring annual progress reports is part of the solution. There is a lack of SME construction companies. Capacity needs to be built. Moving to off-site construction with regional factories for new build and incentivising retrofit startups is part of the solution. Empty buildings that could be homes scar our town centres. More needs to be done to transform them into places to live. Building on best practice, a clear route for local authority and communities to invest in town centre living, along with at-scale support from the Scottish National Investment Bank, is part of the solution. Tens of thousands of empty homes could be brought back into use, using all our taxation and enforcement tools to incentivise the reuse of these homes, and increasing funding for empty homes officers is part of the solution. But even when we take all of these actions, we will still be looking at Scotland's long-term challenges, lack of land. The Land Reform Bill must include ways to bring forward appropriate land and buildings for housing. There is a proposed power for estates to be broken up at a point of sale, but we can't wait for estates to come on the market. What about inheritance? What about urban land reform? We need a secure and appropriate supply of land for housing now. As we've seen with the low numbers of properties supplied under the Affordable Housing Initiative for key worker schemes, all four of which are in Orkney, bringing empty homes back into use takes time. Creating new homes from scratch is even more expensive and challenging, especially in rural communities where land and building costs are high and available skilled workers few and far between. In February, the then First Minister told this chamber that reforming and modernising the compulsory purchase order is vital. It would be good to hear progress on that, as well as the case for compulsory sales orders and compulsory leasing. At a UK level, we must address VAT thresholds, reverse the near 9% cut in the Scottish budget, and reconsider the freeze on local housing allowance rates. We can't continue to peddle the fantasy that we can invest in rebuilding the country after nearly two decades of austerity and stagnation.
Thank you, Ms.
without
Burgess.
Taxing
you must wind
those
up.
Who are most able to afford it. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Rennie, up to 4 minutes, please.
I thought we might be getting somewhere this morning when I read the government's amendment, but I'm sorry that the speech that the minister made was almost exactly the same speech that was made last November, except the words "accepting the housing emergency" has been added in. Nothing else has changed. It was one defence after another in his contribution, and also then blaming Westminster, which is exactly what he did last year. Now, when John Swinney and Kate Forbes contributed to the debate last year, they were very clear. John Swinney said, "I respectfully say to Parliament that it is not enough just to do that, the housing emergency declare. Substantial actions must set out on how we will address the issue." Now, Kate Forbes said, real leadership, is not about accepting the scale of a challenge or explaining what has taken place. It is about stepping back and figuring out how to best resolve the challenge and then getting stuck into delivering some of the solutions. So I would have thought today that we'd hear from the minister what this housing emergency actually meant, because those two people are now in charge. So I would have thought we would have a list of new measures, in addition to other new measures, which the minister's perfectly entitled to defend, but to set out what's different from last November. Why has the government accepted that there is a housing emergency? Now, of course, I accept there is the post-recession financial restrictions. They've had an impact for some time. I accept the Liz Truss budget, of course, has had a disastrous effect on inflation, and of course, Brexit has an impact too. But this government has got a very large, multi-billion pound budget and tax raising powers, so it does have choices. It's not a limited budget. It could do something different, but it's its choices, and its choices it's going to have to defend today. And one of those choices has been a dramatic cut in the More Homes budget. Dramatic cut in that budget. And it's not just the impact, the direct impact of that cut. It's the fact that housing associations lever extra private finance as a result of that funding. That will go down as well. But the problem has been building for years. This is not going to be turned around overnight, but we need to start to reverse the damage. So the acceptance of a housing emergency must mean something, but from the minister, I'm afraid, it means absolutely nothing. Now, I'm afraid to say some of the rhetoric and the proposed measures about the private rented sector is deterring investment in that sector. And we need the government to change tack. And it changed tack on two important measures. The first is we need to accept that private landlords are partners, not the problem. And I'm afraid they've come to believe that they are the problem and the government are out to get them. That needs to change. Whatever the reality of the measures, that needs to change. I'm afraid I've only got 50 seconds left. So that's the first thing that needs to be recognised. The second thing is we need to be cautious and evidence-based about any rent control measures that are introduced, because there is evidence that they act as a floor rather than as a ceiling. So we do need to consider that carefully. And finally, I said two things, I've got three. The mid-market rent properties need to be excluded from any rent control measures, because they are a form of social housing, I believe. So I'm frustrated at the government's response today. I think it really needs to wake up and accept its responsibility for 17 years in government. But so far, I've not been convinced that's the case.
Thank you. And we now move to the open debate. And I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I refer members to my register of interest, where I have a sixth share in a family home? Presiding Officer, the lack of housing is the single biggest issue facing rural Scotland. After 17 years, the Scottish Government now admit we have a housing emergency. But this can't be solved by a tick box exercise. We hear of the £25 million scheme for key workers that has only bought four houses, all in Orkney. Why is that the case? I know from NHS Highland that they have recruited staff only for them to withdraw their applications because they can't find a place to live. Why has this fund not been used? This is especially the case in Skye, and yet the A&E in Portree was closed last weekend during Sky Live, and there were critical health incidents with tragic consequences. How can it be that patients in Sky cannot march for health services due to policing resources being used in Inverness to police an Orange Order march, but Sky Live can go ahead in Sky without adequate ambulance cover, or indeed when the local accident and emergency is closed? The lack of housing is the biggest economic damper we face. Services can't be delivered, depopulation is rife. It's the biggest issue we hear from service providers, from businesses and from individuals. We need a rural burden, especially on homes built with public funding. They need to stay within the local housing market. Can the holiday home second home accommodation be restricted? They now need licences. Can council set a ceiling as to what is the reasonable number of licences they grant, say 10%? And I know while this legislation picks up B&Bs in people's own homes and camping pods, they're not the problem. They, in fact, boost the local economy. We need to count them out of that. But the big problem is family homes. Homes that are suitable for year-round accommodation are being taken out of the local housing market. There is a lack also of socially rented housing. And whatever the government say, they have not overcome the barrier that costs and the lack of economies of scale cause, because one or two houses is what's required in a small village. We all know about the homes in Barra costing £250,000 each to build. And part of this is because of urban planning restrictions. We need to have rural planning to reflect rural housing standards. There is an insistence on streetlights, where actually there's nowhere to go after dark. There is pavements are essential, but there are no pavements for them to join onto. Rainwater collection systems designed for built-up urgent urban areas where there's a nearby river that collects the rainfall. And the connection to services is astronomical. Connection to water, sewerage and telecoms, things that people need. We need to address different ways of doing that. Because what's coming down the track, we hope, is renewable jobs in these areas. Yet, those people cannot be housed there currently. We need new houses. There is a housing emergency everywhere, but we're feeling it most in rural areas, who are always left further behind. The Gaelic language is dying because of the dispersal of native Gaelic speakers. People who want to remain in their own communities but can't afford to get a house, and there's no socially rented houses available. The Scottish Government have now acknowledged that there is a problem. They need to spell out what they're going to do, because, Presiding Officer, depopulation is accelerating and we need answers now.
Thank you. I call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is the point where you stand up and give a completely different speech from what you originally intended to. But the one point that does remain is that for any individual, for any family, without a roof over their heads, that is an emergency, that is a crisis, and governments, whether they be local government, the UK government or the Scottish government, should take cognizance of that. And Arianne Burgess, in her speech, made, I think, the most important point in this debate so far. And that is about collective action and shared responsibility. Because the UK government has a responsibility, local government has responsibilities, and the Scottish government has responsibilities in order to get this absolutely right. And I don't agree with some of the speakers who has said that the Scottish Government should use all of the tools at its disposal to ensure that we do better here. But we have to be realistic. We do not control all of the political and financial tools that we need to resolve some of the difficulties that are out there. And we have heard about the absolutely disastrous Liz Truss mini-budget. Well, I'll gladly give way to Mr Briggs, yeah?
Miles Briggs.
What do you think the Scottish Government has gone wrong?
Kevin Stewart.
Well, I think the Scottish Government has largely done things right, but I think that there are things that we should have pushed much more for. Let's look at what Rhoda Grant was talking about just not minutes ago in terms of the costs of connection to services. Westminster retained power, but we should have been pushing harder to get those costs reduced. That Liz Truss budget set us up, it set us back dramatically. That, no, I won't, I need to carry on. Because that has led to a huge rise in interest rates. It has led to a slashing of capital budgets. And let's look at not what I'm saying or what any politician is saying, but let's look at the UK's own Competition and Markets Authority, which points the finger at high interest rates and mortgage availability for the stopping of building and for people falling into difficulties. Now, that free market regulator, if you like, are making it clear that the governments need to fill the gap in order to get housing on the move again. And for the Scottish Government to step in, Westminster needs to increase the UK's capital investment spend, which they control. Scotland isn't an independent country. Interest rates, monetary policy and capital investment are all controlled by the Westminster system. So what Scotland needs is to end the economic mismanagement by the Westminster parties. We need interest rates to come down, we need capital investment to go up, and we need to build many, many more affordable homes. That is what will end the housing emergency. What we also need to do is we need to look at our local government partners to ensure that they are as up to date as they could be when it comes to allocation policy. We need to be talking to them more around about what additional powers they require to bring homes back into use. Those are key things that we should be doing in the here and now, but also we should not hold back on the fact that many of those levers of power we do not have, and we should be pushing Westminster to make massive changes in that regard to house many more people in homes that are fit for them.
Thank you. I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by wholeheartedly agreeing with the Scottish Labour motion this afternoon? There's no getting around it. Scotland is a grip of a housing crisis. There's been a 10% increase in homelessness applications over the last year, and the number of people who have been assessed as homeless has risen by 4%. According to ONS, the average rent in Edinburgh rose by 15.7% between March last year and March this year. This isn't a problem that just come out of nowhere. It comes as a direct result of the failures of this government over the last 17 years. The vandalism from the SNP on legislation has led to a dramatic lack of affordable housing in Scotland, and we have seen the expected skyrocketing of prices that basic economics tells us happens when there is lack of it. And make no mistake, Presiding Officer, that is what we are seeing here. The Scottish Government has neglected its duty to increase our housing stock over the last number of years, leading to the lack of affordable homes that are available to those who need them. Happy to take Mr Macdonald.
Gordon Macdonald.
Thanks for giving way. I wonder if you could maybe comment on the 11,500 council houses that are lying empty, 1,200 of them here in Edinburgh with the Labour Tory controlled council, 400 in West Lothian with the Labour Tory controlled council. Surely the quickest way to get homes for people, especially when the capital budget's been slashed, is to bring the 11,500 empty council houses back into use.
Jeremy Balfour.
I fully agree that we need to get them back into use. I think let's look at history. Who's been in power most of the time for the last 20 years in Edinburgh? SNP failing locally as well as nationally. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem like that the SNP understand the mess they have made of it. And admittedly, they have no idea how many homes will be built in the coming years. They have slashed the housing budget in a move that the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations has described as a hammer blow for tackling homelessness and poverty. What's more, many of the provisions in the upcoming housing bill promise to further make the problem even worse. We have seen the impact of rent controls over the past year. As already mentioned, the average rent in Edinburgh has increased by over 15%. Thanks to this government, Scotland has joined the long line of countries that have tried their hand at price fixing, only to learn the same lesson that every other administration has learned. If you meddle, it goes on. Sorry, I don't have time. And yet they plan to expand these controls in the upcoming bill. Doesn't that just sum up this government, Presiding Officer? In the face of overwhelming evidence, they plough ahead with their ideological obsession, only to end up in exactly the same mess that we warned and others have warned they would make. And to add insult to injury, in the amendment today, they throw up their hands and say, it wasn't me. Yeah. The SNP must think that people of Scotland are fools. Housing has been devolved since the start of this Parliament. For the entire time in government, it has been their responsibility and they have neglected it. The people of Scotland are not going to accept this rubbish from the SNP amendment that deflects everyone except where the blame lies at their doorstep. To close, Presiding Officer, there is no solution to the housing crisis that doesn't include building more homes. The Scottish Government has to get its act together, ditch its planned rent controls and promote growth in a sector that is essentially holding back our society. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Presiding Officer, Scotland is in a housing emergency, and that housing emergency isn't just about houses, it's about people. It's about the mum who contacted me, who was placed by the council in a caravan with her kids because there wasn't enough temporary homelessness accommodation, never mind a permanent home for her family. It's about the pensioner I visited recently who has to sleep in a bed in her small kitchen because she's too frail to climb the stairs to her bedroom. She uses a commode and hasn't been able to go to her upstairs bathroom for months to properly bath or shower, yet is waiting and waiting and waiting to be rehomed. It's about the young woman I spoke to at my surgery, plagued by antisocial behaviour in her block of flats on her street, desperate to hold on to the security of her social housing tenancy, but has been told it isn't even worth her applying to be rehomed. It's about the young worker who asked me for help because he couldn't take up a job he'd been offered, as there simply was no affordable housing for him and his family in any village within miles of the new opportunity he was desperate for. Presiding officer, that's just a fraction, a very tiny number of the struggles in just the last few months alone I've tried to help people. But their stories are familiar, because this housing emergency isn't new. The government may only be waking up to it today, but it didn't happen overnight. It hasn't happened because of the pandemic. It didn't just happen in this parliament. But in this parliament, we do need to decide if we want to end that housing emergency. The starting point is the government declaring that housing emergency, and I'm pleased, albeit at the second time of asking by Labour, that they're now willing to do so. But more importantly, it means the government setting up what action it will take to deal with it, and we've heard very little of that from the minister. He should begin, presiding officer, but I'll take an intervention on that. Yep.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. I wonder, in the spirit of consensus, if he agrees with me with the reduction we've seen in 62% in financial transactions receipts, which actually gave us a huge amount of flexibility in terms of really ramping up our social housing build, which we can see per the per capita build we've got, whether we actually have to work collectively to try and figure out how do we unlock some of that money that we have that we can invest in social housing. And I think across this chamber, we should be able to do that.
Colin Smith.
I think changes in financial transaction and capital grants is an issue, but the government still made a choice to reduce the housing budget by £196 million. Now, that's a 26% cut, described by the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations as an absolute hammer blow for tackling homelessness, and devastating by Shelter and the Chartered Institute of Housing. Because if the government doesn't make it a budget priority to begin to reverse that cut, the commitment that it still gives to 110,000 new homes in its amendment today will remain, in the words of Glasgow and West of Scotland Forum Housing Association, absolutely dead in the water. We also need a more urgent target when it comes to the building of new homes in rural areas. The Minister is right in the amendment when he says the housing emergency will affect different communities in different areas in different ways. So at a time the population of rural Scotland is 17%, a target of just 10% of the planned affordable homes by 2032 for rural and island areas simply isn't good enough, and I still don't know how the government came to that 10% figure. Ministers should also give local authorities powers to introduce an escalating council tax surcharge on empty homes, a call supported in the responses to the government's own consultation on council tax for second and empty homes, to use that money to invest in new properties. Presiding officer, a warm, affordable home is a basic human right that everyone, whoever they are, wherever they live, is entitled to do. But for far too many of my constituents and everyone's constituents, that's a right they are being denied. And until we don't just accept we have a housing emergency, but actually meet it with an emergency response, the lives of far too many families are going to continue to be held back.
Thank you. And I call Emma Roddick, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, presiding officer. I've got no issue with calling what we're in a housing emergency or crisis or burich or whatever it is that people want to call it, because I don't think it really makes a difference what term we use. What matters is what we do about it. Now, my experience of not having a home is the reason that I am in politics. I experienced a badly designed process and realised that while I didn't have the money to build houses myself, the power to ban bad landlords, or knowledge of where in the world people have done housing better and succeeded at it, I knew what could give others a better experience of seeking support to prevent homelessness. And I'm proud to look at the SNP government and see action that aligns with what I know is the right way to approach housing. Recognition that it's not just about building homes, it's about making sure that the right homes are built in the right places and accessible to those who really need them. It's about supporting people in insecure tenancies to access financial support, know their rights, and be protected from unfair evictions. And it's about making the best use of houses which already exist. From the 2016 Tenancies Act to ending right to buy and the bedroom tax, Scotland does have a good story to tell on housing, and that story isn't finished yet. There are still too many people who are homeless. There are still villages in my region where the heart of the community is barely beating because over half of the houses available have been bought up for second homes and short-term letting. We need to address the housing emergency from all angles, accepting that many people and public sector services have a duty to prevent homelessness wherever they can. Looking at why people who can't pay their rent can't pay their rent. It's the cost of living crisis, a crisis which was inflicted on Scotland by the same UK government which has just delivered an almost 9% cut to the Scottish capital budget. And it's about delivering a house building scheme that reacts to the needs of those on the housing lists across the country, of communities where employers are struggling to fill highly skilled vacancies, and of people who cannot keep up with the cost of private rents and mortgages. Now, I was heartened to see in the government amendment a recognition that the crisis is being felt by some places more than others. And I know that the government is aware of what Rhoda Grant has described, the higher cost of building materials and contractors that could double the cost of building a house in a rural or island area or make it impossible. I was recently in Egg with the Housing Minister and we talked for 2 days about exactly that, the exorbitant cost of building a house in the Isles compared to a whole development in a city, but also how critical that one house can be for that community. It can be the difference between having a school teacher or not, having a healthcare worker or not, and having a functioning community or not. And it's the same story that Yatland Housing Association, Orkney Housing Association and Community Development Trusts up and down the Highlands and Islands will tell you. The Scottish Government, in its grants and support for rural and island builders, needs to recognise that. It also needs the money to do so. So, Presiding Officer, I genuinely welcome the contributions from Labour today, and I hope that in the spirit of consensus, opposition members, while rightly keeping up the pressure on the government to deliver change for those in insecure housing or none, will also join SNP calls on the UK government to undo that harsh cut to capital funding. While we are not an independent country, while we cannot borrow money, we are sadly reliant on the UK government to do the right thing. So let's speak with one voice and recognise what has got us into this situation and what can get us out, and all demand that the UK government does the right thing. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Patrick Harvey. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the fact that we're now all at a point of recognising the reality of the housing emergency, and I regret that a few members seem uncomfortable when consensus breaks out on an issue like that, as well as some very constructive and consensual contributions. We have heard, I'm afraid, one or two that seemed rather petulant. The recognition of the causes of a housing emergency is absolutely critical. And it is silly for a few members simply to say that the Scottish Government itself has led us to where we are at the moment. I will disagree, as I have done in the past, with aspects of Scottish Government policy. I take responsibility for, in some cases, not being able to act as fast as I might have wished on some issues when I was part of the Scottish Government. But the idea that we discount all of the causal factors of this housing emergency that are outside the Scottish Government's control would be absurd. Now, Emma Roddick, I think, laid them out very clearly a few moments ago. The cost of living crisis, insecure work, extreme rents and UK government welfare cuts, these are the factors that lead so many more individuals into a position of housing crisis. Brexit and inflation are significant structural aspects in relation to the housing system. Now, as well as those factors, of course, there are long-standing aspects of our housing system itself which we need to recognise. But the idea that these recent, in the last few years, these recent economic circumstances don't create and shape the housing emergency is absurd. I want to say something about supply, because Mark Griffin, Miles Briggs, Kevin Stewart, I think almost everybody who spoke said something about supply. Supply of housing is, of course, a big part of the picture, but it is not the whole of the picture. And there have been some simplistic arguments, not just here, but in wider public debate on supply. The ratio of homes to people has not changed so dramatically in the last few years as to create this housing emergency. The distribution of housing is equally significant. Mark Griffin rightly spoke about empty and second homes, and action is being taken on that. The nature of new supply is also important as well. It's not just the number of homes that gets built. What are they and where are they? I see people talking about the important role of build to rent. Well, many of the build to rent developments I see being promoted are £2,000 a month flats at the luxury high end. I see housing developments being, you know, are we losing the risking losing investment in housing for sale? And some of what's being built is, you know, 250, 300 grand homes. Are these being built for social need? Or are they being built principally for the interests of investors? And I think we need to ask those structural questions about the nature of our housing market. I'm afraid I've had very little time. Price increasingly needs to be recognised as well. And rent control is a critical part of our coherent response to the climate to the housing emergency. Slip of the tongue there, I beg your pardon. I can't accept that investment in housing must depend on extreme rent rises, or that we should simply accept that ever more people will be stuck in the most expensive and least secure tenure. So supply is important, but it's the nature of supply. The Greens will be supporting both the amendments. The government amendment, it would be implausible not to mention the context of this housing emergency as the government amendment does. We'll support the Conservative amendment with some caveats. For example, the Homelessness Prevention Strategy Group is leading on the actions that result from the Task and Finish Group. That's where the leadership of that work should continue. Notwithstanding what's in the amendment, there are aspects of that amendment I wouldn't want to lose. But finally, Presiding Officer, it is also astonishing to ignore the role of the UK government, or for those political parties who want to spend ever more on public services but will not recognise the need for progressive taxation that's already put an extra £1.5 billion into the Scottish Government budget for public services, but they oppose the taxation
Thank
that raises
you,
the money
Harvey.
To spend on the services they want.
You must conclude. And I call on Graeme Simpson. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. Presiding Officer, when we debated housing in November, the Minister was in denial about the existence of a housing emergency. Well, there was an emergency then, and it's got worse since. So can I thank Labour for bringing this debate to the Chamber? Because it's finally forced the Minister to admit reality. But it would have been helpful if he'd thrown away the usual SNP script of blaming someone else and accepted some of the responsibility. The SNP amendment paints a rosy picture of what they're doing, but says the emergency is all down to the UK government. Well, here's the thing. If we didn't have 1.5 million people being denied a safe, stable home, living in overcrowded, dangerous, unstable or unaffordable housing, if we didn't have 15,600 households in temporary accommodation, if funding for affordable housing supply had not been cut by £196 million, if we didn't have a record 9,500 children trapped in temporary accommodation, if 45 children were not becoming homeless every day, if a household was not becoming homeless every 16 minutes, if 16,263 children were not being assessed or threatened with homelessness in 2022-2023, if Scotland did not have the highest rent increases of anywhere in the UK, and if five councils, Argyll and Bute, Edinburgh, Fife, Glasgow and West Dumbartonshire, had not declared a housing emergency, then you can bet your life that that much better picture would be nothing at all to do with Westminster and everything to do with the SNP in what, after all, is a devolved area. The Minister should be handing... No, the Minister should be handing Shirley Ann Somerville the record back and telling her to put something else on. This is a boring tune and it is not helping. Now, last month, the Minister ran the gauntlet of property professionals at an event at Strathclyde University. And property developer Chris Stewart told him to loud applause, "You have a market." There is a £3 billion of investment sitting there. You killed the market. He said there was a massive disconnect between what the government is saying and what has happened. And he added, the market was there, the tenant demand was there, along with responsible developers and institutional investors providing a product, and it's just stopped. Now, I agree with Mr. Stewart, but the guy he should have been directing his fire at wasn't there. It's not Paul McLennan who has killed the market, it's Patrick Harvey. And now that Mr. Harvey is no longer in government, then it's up to Mr. McLennan to fix the mess. He could start by putting the housing bill on hold and getting rid of mad proposals for rent controls. No doubt when he was at that conference, he would have heard James Blakey, planning director at Moda Living, say that his company had £450 million of investment ready to be signed off, but it will not happen because of the bill. Miles Briggs revealed this week that the government has no idea how many homes need to be built. But we do know that there are already issues being caused by MPF4 with site stalling and building rates slowing. Now that the minister admits that there is a housing emergency, then he needs to take responsibility, own the problem and act on it.
Thank you. And I call on Shirley Ann Somerville, up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It is clear that the Scottish Government has recognised that there is a real and genuine challenge within the housing sector, and we have done for some time. And as my colleague Emma Roddick quite rightly put it in her speech earlier on, I think it is very important that we move past debating how we define a problem and move on to the solutions. That's why I am very happy that we do so today and that we all collectively declare that there is a housing emergency. Because the important point, as members right across the chamber have came to, is what we then do about it. Now, the aspects that we have laid out in the amendment today are about setting the context. And that is a very important aspect, because none of us, as we debate those solutions, can forget or just simply imagine away the financial context that we're in. So we do have, fact, a decrease in the capital budget given by the UK Government to the Scottish Government of 9%. That's £1.3 billion being taken out of Scottish Government plans. Now, that inevitably brings real challenges to all of us as we move forward to see what can be done about it. If you'll forgive me, I'll make a little bit more progress. Thank you. Now, I'm very keen that we do look at the record. Of course we do. But I would say to those who have suggested that the amendment is self-congratulating, I have deliberately put the amendment together to ensure that it is not. It states the context, it states the record, but it states the challenge. Because I want us all collectively to get together and discuss and agree the fact that the capital budget has gone down, and we collectively demand that the UK Government reverse those cuts. Certainly.
Miles Briggs.
I've listened to the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister. I think the problem they're having is they need to look in the mirror on this. Not just looking at Westminster, but look at what's gone wrong in Scotland. We heard earlier members talking about the Rural Housing Fund. £25 million have just delivered in 1 year just 4 homes. So that's a total failure, and I think the government's not understanding why they are part of the problem.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll get on to that issue in particular about how collectively we have responsibility and collectively we all need to raise our game. But can I point out just on that fund that that is but one fund that deals with rural housing supply, and there have been over 200 homes supplied by another fund that we have to assist with rural and island homes. But, Presiding Officer, Willie Rennie quite rightly challenged the Government about what's changed. What's changed since the last debate, for example, is another £80 million of an uplift, particularly looking at acquisitions, that will deal quickly and directly with temporary accommodation and homelessness. The introduction of a housing bill, talking about that Ask and Act homelessness duties, which I really hope Graeme Simpson doesn't want the Government to ditch, because that would be a real wasted opportunity. And we have, of course, within that housing bill, looked at the private rented sector as well. Now, members have discussed rent controls. I appreciate there are differing views across the committee. Can I say to those, Willie Rennie and Graeme Simpson, Graeme Simpson just yesterday was commending the Housing Minister on how he took forward the cladding bill. He will do that in exactly the same way on the housing bill. So people who have different opinions, whether it's on rent controls or on other aspects of it, you have seen the way that this government intends to take through legislation and the way that the Housing Minister deals with legislation. His door is always open, and I hope the member would agree that that is indeed the case on this. So it is important that we do work together on this, because it is important that we recognise that as much the Scottish Government can do, but as much the UK Government has to do. Yes, it's the reversal of that 9% cut. Local housing allowances is one of the biggest impacts on homelessness, and the asylum process is what caused the housing crisis and emergency in Glasgow. Councils also have to play their part. We have some councils whose policies aren't up to date. How can we learn from the good practice of some to ensure that we are providing a tailored approach that the councils decide, but they've looked at all of those aspects? How do we tackle the voids issues, which are too high in some areas? Why is some money being handed back to the Scottish Government and not used by councils, and yet still they didn't say that there is an issue? Now, of course, we are in danger, I think, if we accept the Tory amendment, of spending time doing another action plan. And that's genuinely my only issue with the Tory amendment. I'd rather focus on implementation delivery, not delivery of another action plan. And if Parliament wants that, well, so be it. We will go forward with it. But we have an opportunity for all arms of government to work together. How do all parties work together? Ariane Burgess talked about collective action and shared responsibility.
We must conclude,
that's
Cabinet
the way
Secretary.
This government is determined to do it. There is a challenge for everyone across the chamber to rise to that occasion as well. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Sarah Boyack to wind up. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I would like to kick off by drawing members' attention to my register of interest for my former work with SFHA. And I want to start my contribution this afternoon by thanking Shelter Scotland for their tireless campaign on this issue, but also to all the homeless charities who prevent homelessness and then support people to recover from what is a horrific experience that no one should have to go through. And I also want to thank the many constituents who have been in touch to share their experiences of the housing emergency we are facing in Edinburgh and the Lothians. But like many others around the room, I am getting a sense of déjà vu, because we're back in the chamber arguing that Scotland's in a housing emergency. What has changed in the last few months is a little pot of money from the Scottish Government, but also more local authorities declaring a housing emergency, more worries about systemic failure happening in our councils and at risk in our councils. So we need to act now. If we can agree unanimously that we face a housing crisis and an emergency, that will be a start, but we then need to look at the policies that we can work across the whole of Scotland on. Just think about the... Let me get started. Just think about the impact of the lives of those 10,000 children who do not have a safe and permanent home, and how that impacts on their lives. And it will look different in every local authority. There are key issues that need to be addressed. Several members, Rhoda Grant, Colin Smith, Emma Roddick, talked about the rural challenge we've got, short-term accommodation, the lack of affordable housing so that people cannot afford to stay in their rural communities. And the heartbreaking experience Colin Smith mentioned, I think we could all quote problems. I have a constituent that wrote to me to say, I simply don't have an extra £200 a month in my already tight budget. I'm a single mother, already cutting back on everything to provide for bills and food for my 7-year-old son and myself. If I don't pay such a high rent, we'll be evicted and end up homeless. It's a real problem. We don't have enough affordable social rented housing, and the overall shortage of housing is pushing up the cost of private rented properties. So we need more new housing, and we need it right across the country. Briefly, yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
If we are all now agreeing that there is a housing emergency, I take it that that also includes a UK government, the current government, and any incoming Labour government. So will any incoming Labour government recognise the housing emergency, their role in that, have a reduction and indeed stop the 9% cuts, no freezes to local housing allowances and support for councils on asylum? Because if not, then they are not taking their responsibility for what they could do.
Sarah Boyack.
A Labour government could not come soon enough, because after the economic crisis we've seen that was mentioned by Kevin Stewart and others, the Liz Truss budget is not funny. It felt funny in terms of the lettuce, but it has damaged our economy and it's seen people's mortgages rocketing. So yes, we need a Labour government and we need it urgently. We need action. One of the things mentioned by several people was the fact that, no, this is a debate. We're allowed each to speak. We have 46... No, I won't. We have 46,000 empty homes in Scotland. That was mentioned, the issue was mentioned by Ariane Burgess. We need action. We don't need a small scale approach. We need to work with our local authorities and support them so that they have the staff to pursue compulsory sale orders, so that they have the staff to actually promote urban regeneration, and so we bring empty homes back into use. But we need to be so much more ambitious. When the housing bill comes in front of us, we will work constructively. I'm responding to the debate. We need effective rent controls, but the bill itself will not lead to one new house being built. So I hope the Scottish Government will work constructively with all the members across the chamber who have been putting forward practical solutions today, because we need action now. I'll come back to the point that there are 10,000 children in temporary accommodation. That is a national scandal. It's a 138% increase over the last decade. And if the First Minister is serious when he says he wants to tackle child poverty, we need to start with finding affordable housing, funding it right across the country. And as we celebrate 25 years of devolution, it's important to remember that housing was baked into the devolution settlement from day one. And I will agree with Shirley-Ann Somerville, we need the Scottish, the UK government and every single local council to work together. Because we've seen 17 years of this SNP government wasting huge amounts of money, £196 million on failed ferry contracts alone. We need an effective government. 80% of the people of Scotland agree that we're in a housing emergency. So today, let us take this as a starting point. In his speech, my colleague Mark Griffin gave a raft of potential solutions that we are happy to work with the Scottish Government on. The Scottish Government...
Ms Boyack
is in her last
minute. I am down
to the last 30 seconds, I think. We need to have new houses being built. We need practical solutions. We need new homes right across Scotland. Our constituents deserve nothing less. Emergencies demand responses. We are an emergency. It's time to respond. It's time to build the new homes, bring back homes into use, and tackle the poor quality housing we have in Scotland, because people deserve that and they need it now.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scotland's housing emergency. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 13230 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill.